Welcome. My name is Pastor Charles Manti. I'm pastor at St. Mark Lutheran Church in Salem, Oregon. On behalf of the congregation, I wish to welcome you for this worship for the fifth Sunday of Lent, March 29th, 2020. We begin with a prelude by Susan Johnson. It is Meditation on Love Unknown by Francis Jackson. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who is present, who gives life, who calls into existence the things that do not exist.
Amen.
If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand? Yet with you is forgiveness, and so we confess. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned away from you, knowingly and unknowingly. We have wandered from your resurrection life. We have strayed from your love for all people. Turn us back to you, O God. Give us new hearts and right spirits, that we may find what is pleasing to you and dwell in your house forever. Amen. Receive the good news. God turns to you in love. I will put my spirit in you, and you shall live, says our God. All your sin is forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ, who is the free and unbounding gift of God's grace for you. Amen. We sing the hymn, Christ, the Life of All the Living, ELW number 339. The free gift of grace in Jesus Christ, the reconciling love of God, and the life and peace of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
his holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son came into the world to free us all from sin and death. Breathe upon us the power of your Spirit, that we may be raised to new life in Christ and serve you in righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from Ezekiel. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied, and as I had been commanded, and as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live.' I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, 'Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. And I will bring you back to the land of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will speak Psalm 130 responsively, whole verse by whole verse. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord.
O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication.
If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand?
Yet with you is forgiveness, in order that you may be feared.
I wait for you, O Lord. My soul waits. In your word is my hope.
My soul waits for the Lord more than those who keep watch for the morning, more than those who keep watch for the morning.
O Israel, wait for the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love. With the Lord there is plenteous redemption.
For the Lord shall redeem Israel from all their sins.
A reading from Romans. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the spirit, since the spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the spirit is life because of righteousness. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead, who will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his spirit that dwells in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Once again, the reading today is rather long. I would invite you to close your eyes and imagine the scene before you. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and you are going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am there, going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of the One coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were coming with her in the house consoling her saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her, because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Let us pray. Merciful God, in these days, we thank you for your presence with us moment by moment. We may not feel it always, but we know that you never leave us or abandon us. Give us grace in this moment to hear your word. In Christ's name, amen. When I was a child, One of the most embarrassing things that would happen to me, on rare occasions, fortunately, was that I would become uncontrollably tearful following a loss. I still remember shedding tears over losing a spelling bee in the second grade. It was particularly painful when it happened at school. When Jesus arrives in Bethany following the death of his friend Lazarus, Jesus weeps. Jesus does not try to hide his tears. Jesus loved his friend. Maybe they were best friends. The neighbor said, "See how he loved him." Jesus' humanity was truly revealed in how much this one death affected him more than others. No death is easy. I've officiated at many funerals, but there are certain ones that just leave me weeping. See how he loved him. Bethany was about 2 miles outside of Jerusalem. It's the place where the siblings, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, lived and where Jesus must have visited often. The word Bethany means literally house of affliction. The story of the raising of Lazarus is intentionally paired with one of the most famous stories found in the book of the prophet Ezekiel, the story of the Valley of the Dry Bones. This story is also about grief. When we are grieving, it may feel like we are gazing on a valley full of dry bones. Ezekiel is speaking from Babylon. He was taken into exile there from his home in Judea as a young man in 597 BCE, about 10 years before the Babylonians destroyed Jerusalem and the temple. There in Babylon, he was called to be a prophet, and in a vision, Ezekiel is brought to the middle of a valley full of bones, and they were very, very dry. The bones symbolize Judah's lament. Our bones are dried up and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Ezekiel's vision of the valley of dry bones is God's response to the sense of hopelessness of the exiles who had lost land, temple, and family. These are not the bones of the slain, but the bones of those who have survived the exile. Their bones were indeed dried up. What's being dealt with is not death, but absolute despair. The prophet is to speak to the bones, and he does so. There is a noise, a rattling, and the bones come together, bone to its bone, then sinews, then flesh. But Ezekiel saw no breath in them. It would seem that Babylon had knocked the breath out of Judah. They have no breath. They have no spirit. They have no ruach. The Hebrew word ruach is repeated 10 times in this passage, and it can be translated breath, wind, or spirit. God commands Ezekiel to prophesy to the breath, to the spirit, to the ruach, and Ezekiel does so. The spirit breathes breath, the spirit breath blows from the four winds, and the bodies live and stand. This breath, this wind, is the same spirit that moved over the face of the waters at the beginning of creation. It is the same breath that God breathed into Adam's nostrils, the breath of life. And then the man became a living soul. Breathing is a metaphor for God's presence. The promise of this story is that God is near to the exiles as their own breath. Because God is present, they can breathe. God's promise did not mean that the situation the exiles faced was any different, but they could face the challenges with their breath, their spirit restored. They still grieved over the loss of the land, the temple, their loved ones, but there was a difference. God's presence, even in Babylon, turns hopelessness into hope, faint-heartedness into courage. So it was when Jesus approached the tomb of Lazarus. When Jesus cries, "Lazarus, come out," breath returns to the dead man and he rises. God's word is the force that brings life out of death in both these stories. Why then does Jesus do this the hard way? Why does he wait? Why does he take his time? Why doesn't he come earlier to Lazarus' bedside and nurse him back to health? Why does he weep with the mourners, knowing that Lazarus' breath will be returned to him? Those who doubt Jesus see his tears and ask these very questions. Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? It is a question that stops many people from believing in Christ because it is logically impossible to answer. And we crave answers that make sense. If God can do one thing, why not another? If Jesus can still the winds and the waves, why does he allow earthquakes and tsunamis? If Jesus fed 5,000 with a little boy's lunch, why does anyone anywhere go to bed hungry at night? If Jesus breathed life into Lazarus, why does he not wipe out the terrible effects of the coronavirus? Even Mary and Martha say, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." It seems that Jesus is not in the business of keeping bad things from happening. Jesus does the harder thing. He is in the business of bringing God's life-giving breath, God's spirit, to people in the very midst of their grief, of their dying, of their anguish and fear. In the face of the pandemic, we all live in towns called Bethany, called houses of affliction, filled with innocents who have and will die unfairly. Humankind has had its breath knocked out through the rapid spread of the coronavirus. These biblical stories give us another perspective on this pandemic. Ezekiel sees only dry bones, but God brings spirit and life. Jesus weeps, but he does not let death get the last word. He talks back to death and boldly walks right toward it, not only to the tomb of Lazarus, but in a few short days to a cross outside Jerusalem. These are passages that inspire courage, for the church is given the breath of God. The people of the church have been anointed with the Holy Spirit, the Holy Breath, in their baptism. They have been inbreathed. The promise is for us in our crisis, just as much as it is for the Babylonian exiles and the Jews around Jesus. Bad things may happen, but God's Spirit is with you. Breathe it in. This is a season of Lent. Christians over the centuries have engaged in faith practices in these 40 days. We fast, we give alms, we pray, we worship as we are able, we study, we do acts of service. Faith practices in which we intentionally engage do restore us. Last fall, Dr. Charles McGee shared with us in a forum how a simple gratitude practice makes positive changes in our brains. Simply identifying three things we are grateful for before we go to bed at night is somehow restorative. We practice our faith in the season of Lent so that we know what to do when things get harder. Well, folks, things are harder. These disciplines of the season prepare us to face with courage whatever suffering or loss we may encounter. They become a bolster, a lifting up, a breath of fresh air, so that we might stand before that which we fear. When it all seems too much, when you come to the place where you feel dried up like those bones, are lifeless like as though without breath, are feeling entombed, see how God loves you. Listen to the word of God. I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. O my people, I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live. Whenever we are tempted to despair, Martin Luther would say, remember the waters of your baptism. Remember who you are as a child of God. I think the prophet Ezekiel would remind you that on those dark days, to remember to breathe. God is as close to you as you're breathing. Breathe deep and live into God's fullness. And the Spirit granted to you in baptism will sustain you until life's end. We may weep today, but these are tears precious to God, just as the tears that fell from the eyes of Jesus. Our tears are not the end. They foreshadow the new life promised by God. Be of good courage. The Lord is with you. Amen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our prayers this day are taken from the intercessory prayer in the midst of the spread of COVID-19 from the Lutheran World Federation. The response is, "Hear our cry, O God, listen to our prayer." O God, our healer, show your compassion for the whole human family that is in turmoil and burdened with illness and with fear. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Come to our aid as the coronavirus spreads globally. Heal those who are sick. Support and protect their families and friends from being infected. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Grant us your spirit of love and self-discipline so that we may come together working to control and eliminate the coronavirus. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Make us vigilant, attentive, and proactive in the eradication of all diseases, malaria, dengue, HIV and AIDS, and others, that create suffering and often result in death for many people. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Heal our self-centeredness and indifference that makes us worry only when the virus threatens us. Open ways beyond timidity and fear that too easily ignore our neighbor. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Strengthen and encourage those in public health services and in the medical profession, caregivers, nurses, attendants, doctors, all who commit themselves to caring for the sick and their families. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Inspire, give insight and hope to all researchers focused on developing a vaccine. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Sustain all workers and business owners who suffer loss of livelihood due to shutdowns, quarantines, closed borders, and other restrictions. Protect and guard all those who must travel. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Guide the leaders of the nations that they speak the truth. Halt the spread of misinformation and act with justice so that all your family may know healing. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
God of life, you weep with those who grieve. Unbind all who are held captive by anxiety, despair, pain, or illness, especially Robert, Dana, Tom and Breda, Charlene, Elvin and Mary, Alice, Luann, Paul, Pat, the West family, Mason, Linda, Marvin, Butch and Beverly, Sonny, Vic, Chuck, Ruth, Rolf, Tim, Harry, Diane, Maureen, Bud, and Peyton. Fill us with compassion and empathy for those who struggle, and keep us faithful in prayer. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Hold in your gentle embrace all who have died, especially Carolyn Devine and Pastor Ray McKechnie, and who will die this day. Comfort their loved ones in their despair. Hear our cry, O God.
Listen to our prayer.
Remember all your family, the entire human race, and all your creation in your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy and generous host, set a table where we feast as friends. Prepare us to witness to your goodness with every gift you have given us to share, that all people may know your peace through Jesus Christ, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. We sing the Lamb of God.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Christ broken for you. The body of Christ. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. We thank you, living God, for the body and blood of your Son, which sustains us in the wilderness and the garden alike. As Christ has loved us in this feast, so send us to love Christ in our neighbors. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Our closing hymn, number 705.
courage for the facing of this song. For the facing of this song. Lord, the hosts of evil around us scorn the Christ, assail his ways from the fears that long. Grant us courage for the living of these days, for the living of these days. Cure your children's roaring madness, bend our pride to your control. Shame our wanton selfish gladness, your kingdom's goal, lest we miss your kingdom's goal. Save us from the resignation to the evils we endure. Let the gift of your salvation be
now is the acceptable time. Now is the day of salvation. Holy God, speaking, spoken, and inspiring, bless you, unbind you, and send you in love and in peace. Amen. Go in peace. Share the good news. Thanks be to God. Our postlude will be Fugue from Mendelssohn's Sixth Organ Sonata.